Good morning, everyone. I'm Richard Newell, President and CEO of Resources for the Future, or RFF. Thanks so much for joining us for Big Decisions 2023, which is an annual event we have here at RFF to look forward and forecast some of the biggest issues where decision-making will be important over the next year in the area of energy, environment, and climate. Over the next 90 minutes, we'll be hearing from some of the country's top experts and decision makers from a wide variety of perspectives, from government, from nonprofit institutions, and also other outlets. We'll be hearing from the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, the U.S. Department of Agriculture, the Department of Energy, the Bipartisan Policy Center, and the Washington Post. So we'll be exploring some of the biggest priorities that we've identified at RFF for important areas of decision making. It will also be looking to our experts to reflect on that and hopefully also offer their own perspective on things that we may have missed or some of the most important issues that will inform our analysis at RFF and hopefully your focus of the next year as well. One housekeeping note, this event is being recorded. It'll be available afterward at rff.org/events. And with that, it's my great pleasure to introduce and welcome our first expert of the morning, Janet McCabe, the Deputy Administrator of the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. Janet, welcome. We'd all hope that the Deputy Administrator would be here with us in person, but circumstances have led us to shift to a virtual fireside chat. Luckily, we have that option now. Janet, really want to welcome you, and thanks so much for making this work.
Absolutely, and I'm really so sorry I can't be there in person, but I have the standard reason for not being there that probably most people in the audience have experienced themselves.
Yes, exactly. Well, I'm really glad that this is working. We're going to have a great conversation nonetheless. So a bit of background on Deputy Administrator McCabe, currently serving as the Deputy Administrator for the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. Janet's a career public servant who has spent time working in EPA's air office, state environmental agencies in Indiana and Massachusetts, and at a children's environmental health advocacy organization based in Indianapolis. Prior to rejoining EPA in 2021, she was professor of the practice at Indiana University's McKinney School of Law and director of the IU Environmental Resilience Institute. Janet, thanks so much for joining us this morning. It's really a pleasure to have you.
Well, thanks. As I said, I'm really happy to be here virtually.
So over the next 25 minutes, the Deputy Administrator and I will be exploring some of the big issues for 2023, particularly for the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. And following that, my colleague Kevin Rennert will take the stage and welcome our panel of additional experts for an hour-long discussion on the wider issues on deck for this year. So with that, let's kick it off. The Bipartisan Infrastructure Law and the Inflation Reduction Act were two historic policy packages that were passed in the last 14 months, and they provide major infusions of funding for the federal government, including the Environmental Protection Agency. A key provision of the IRA is the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund, which is a $27 billion fund to finance entities that will support communities across the U.S. by dispersing low-cost, flexible financing for clean energy projects. So with that, what does the fund have in store for 2023? And how is EPA assessing where, how, and to whom to disperse the $20 billion in the general fund and how that is going to be distributed? Janet, give us your reflections on that.
Yeah, what a great place to start. And let me just say how much I appreciate the title of your conference, Big Decisions, because boy, there are sure a lot of them to be made over the next couple of years. We are so excited at EPA about the opportunities that the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund and the entire Inflation Reduction Act and the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law provide to moving forward on our mission to protect human health and the environment and to work on the incredible challenge of climate change. So we are full steam ahead and have been working very quickly to stand up the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund program. As you mentioned, Richard, it's $27 billion, that's with a B, for low-cost capital and technical assistance for zero-emissions projects. This is the largest non-tax investment in the entire Inflation Reduction Act, and represents about 10% of the climate spending in the IRA. And more than half of those funds are statutorily required to go to low-income and disadvantaged communities, which, as folks know, is a huge priority of President Biden and also of Administrator Regan at EPA. The statute is also, as applies to us, is less than about 5 pages. So you can imagine that leaves a long list of questions for EPA to answer in consultation with others, experts, in and outside of government about how best to use these resources and to achieve the key goals that we see that Congress and the president were after with this law, including lowering greenhouse gas emissions, the key thing to do that we need to do in order to mitigate climate change, benefiting low-income and disadvantaged communities, and using public funds to mobilize significant private capital that will be needed in order to decarbonize the American economy, because even $27 billion is not nearly enough to accomplish that goal. So we've been doing a lot of getting feedback from people. We've been holding information sessions, webinars, taking written comment from, and I've heard from hundreds of members of the public, including experts across the whole range of expertise that would be relevant here, to help build our information, our feedback from our request for information that we put out. And we're actively using that feedback to shape, to look through and decide what the key program decisions are and starting to make those decisions. And we look forward to sharing additional information very soon here with people in the coming months.
Quick follow-up, Janet. You know, one of the questions that I've heard asked is whether it's clear at this point whether the EPA intends to kind of directly distribute these funds, whether to kind of use existing institutions that would be kind of the intermediaries for distributing the funds, or maybe kind of enable the creation of a new institution that would play that role. Is that clear at this point, or is that still something that's under deliberation?
I'd say those are the kinds of things that we're still discussing, but we expect to be making those decisions in the fairly near future. So we'll come back to you with that.
All right, great. So what are some of the other, if we take a step back for a second, what are some of the other big ways that these two laws, the Inflation Reduction Act and the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law, are affecting the way that EPA does its business and its work in the year ahead?
Yeah. Well, let me just start by emphasizing how much additional funds these two laws bring to EPA, and that they are funds that are to be gotten out into the country as soon as possible to make a difference on the ground in communities. So to just put it in perspective, EPA's annual budget is about $10 billion a year. That's our base budget. These two laws are bringing more than $100 billion in additional funds to deploy between the two laws over the next 5+ years. This is, as I said, this is all money to support local communities, cities, towns, states, tribes, taking action in their communities to improve drinking water and wastewater, to address brownfields and Superfund sites, and to do these things on the ground that are going to make their communities healthier and safer, are going to create jobs, are going to modernize the infrastructure of our country, replace lead service lines across the country, reduce air pollution, just the whole range of really incredible benefits that these two bipartisan laws are going to bring to the country. So the influx of funds allows us to really expand our grant making and our infrastructure work in a way that EPA hasn't really been able to before. So that's really exciting for us.
Exactly. Pivoting a bit, the unified regulatory agenda just came out, and EPA clearly has a very busy time ahead for the coming year. It includes a number of important priorities that we'll all be tracking in 2023, including federal regulation for emissions from motor vehicles and power plants, actions on renewable fuels, and also methane emissions from oil and gas reduction, just to name a few. Estimates suggest that the Inflation Reduction Act and the incentives that you just were talking about, Janet, could deliver about 40% emission reductions relative to 2005 levels toward the U.S.'s commitment of a 50 to 52% reduction by 2030. So that leaves an important role for other regulatory actions to underpin the transition to a net zero economy over time and also address other harms. So question, so what should we be expecting from EPA over the coming year in terms of action on these key regulatory areas?
Yeah, well, you're right, Richard, that the regulatory responsibility of EPA under the country's fundamental environmental statutes is a really necessary part of the country's response to climate change challenge. And so we are hard at work on the items that you mentioned, as well as others, building on the progress that we've already made in the first 2 years. But of course, regulations, if you do them right, if you base them on science and evidence, if you get people's input, if you make sure that you're following the law, they take a while to develop and get out into the world. So you're going to see a lot of progress on our regulatory agenda in 2023. And I know this is a question that people are always really interested in when EPA comes to sessions like this. So I won't make any news today, but I will emphasize that we're working on regulations affecting the power sector. That includes the finalizing our review of the mercury and air toxics appropriate and necessary standard. So we expect to finalize that soon, and also to propose a review of the mercury and air toxics risk and technology review pretty early in the year. We're due to finalize the Good Neighbor Plan, another rule that builds on past regulations dealing with cross-boundary air pollution, highly significant rules to improve air quality across the country, and have been and will be engaging with people on a proposal for under Section 111 relating to new and existing electric generating units. We expect to be getting that on the street in the spring. We have a lot of work on the transportation side. Folks, I'm sure, know that we put out a very significant rule on heavy-duty transportation right before the holidays. Very proud of that rule, strongest ever national clean air standards for smog and soot-forming pollutants from heavy-duty engines. We expect to propose multi-pollutant emission standards for light and medium-duty vehicles, model years 2027 and later this spring. We're also working on a new heavy-duty greenhouse gas phase 3 rule for model years 27 through 30 plus, and expect a proposal also in the spring of this year. So one of the exciting things that I want to say about all of this is that the opportunities that the Inflation Reduction Act in particular, but also the bipartisan infrastructure law give there, it's really important for us to be taking into account the opportunities that those laws provide to help industries and help people move in the direction of reducing pollution, especially greenhouse gas pollution, because there's all the support through the Inflation Reduction Act. You mentioned oil and gas. And that is a big priority for us. We do expect to be finalizing the new source performance standards for oil and gas fairly soon. We're also working on updates to our greenhouse gas reporting program that will apply to a broader array of sectors and update the global warming potential of GHGs, of methane in particular. The greenhouse gas reporting program, you know, it sounds like kind of a snoozer, but as so many people in this field know, the first place you start when you're trying to reduce emissions is to make sure that they're being measured and monitored and reported in a transparent way. And that forms the basis for future regulation, but it also just shines a light on the emissions that are coming. We're also working to continue the implementation of the requirements of the AIM Act and the Kigali Amendment to reduce hydrofluorocarbons. These are some of the most potent greenhouse gas emissions, and we're really excited about the work that's going forward on that. We have a significant regulatory agenda in other areas too. I'm sure people are following our work on PFAS, our work on lead under our lead strategy, and happy to get a little bit more into detail on those if people are interested, but I don't want to drone on about regulatory activities to the exclusion of everything else.
Yeah, no, thanks for that overview. There's clearly a lot of important action over the next year. Just to reflect on a couple things you've said, and maybe pose a follow-up question, which is, you know, one of the important influences of the Inflation Reduction Act and the infrastructure law is kind of on the baseline environment within which additional EPA regulations, you know, will be deployed. And so do you have a sense of when some, you know, so this from a modeling point of view and an analytic point of view, this requires kind of updating what we call kind of the baseline scenario. Do you have a sense of when we might be seeing that manifest itself in different EPA regulatory impact analysis? When will we start to see the impact of the Inflation Reduction Act on the kind of future baseline that EPA is working from? Do you have a sense of that?
Yeah. So I mean, we are working now on doing those kind of analytics to make sure that our baselines takes into account the changes that we expect to see through the Inflation Reduction Act. So you'll start seeing that when we start putting information out about these individual rule packages.
Yeah, excellent. The other point you made, you know, your point about the greenhouse gas inventory reporting, and which I totally agree with you, may sound like a snoozer, but the world of emissions accounting has become so critical for so many different decisions, as you know, different, you know, procurement standards and actually tax incentives and many other different policies, as well as kind of corporate actions around environment, investor interest in the greenhouse gases embodied in different assets, that really has been elevated hugely in importance.
Yeah, couldn't agree with you more.
So while we look ahead to pivot a bit, to this next year, we also, I think it's helpful to look back to the past year that we just left behind, including the June 2022 Supreme Court ruling on West Virginia versus EPA. And so the question is how that ruling is affecting EPA's approach to its work in 2023 and beyond.
Yeah, good question. The EPA, of course, is very, very mindful of all Supreme Court precedent that applies to the work that we do, but we are confident that decision does not preclude EPA from carrying out its statutory responsibility to protect public health and the environment, which is our number one responsibility. So what that means is that we look very carefully at all of our regulatory work as we go forward to make sure that we're operating in a manner that's consistent with that decision and all others. I could point out that the doctrine that was addressed in that is framed as applying to extraordinary cases. This is not something that we expect to be a major barrier for EPA to go forward to carry out Congress's desires and expectations with respect to the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, and our other environmental statutes.
Okay, thank you for that. I guess we'll see when the rules come out. We'll each maybe have our own interpretation of how that may or may not have been influenced by the Supreme Court decision. You mentioned earlier importance of federal funds flow to disadvantaged communities and EJ communities. So January 27th will mark the 2-year anniversary of President Biden's Executive Order 14008, which announced the Justice 40 Initiative. And that initiative directs federal agencies, including the EPA, to deliver at least 40% of the benefits of certain federal programs to disadvantaged communities. So can you tell us 2 years on how Justice 40 has been implemented to date at EPA, and what are some of the EPA's most important actions and biggest environmental justice priorities, for 2023?
Yeah, Justice 40 is an amazing expression of this president's commitment to really making a difference in communities that have been forgotten too long and that are under an unfair burden of pollution and everything that that brings. And so it's just very exciting to be part of an EPA and part of an administration that is literally putting its money where its mouth is through something like Justice 40. EPA, of course, for many, many years has been very mindful of environmental justice. We see it every single day. And so many of the programs that we are responsible for implementing are focused on areas where attention has not been paid sufficiently in the past. That said, Justice 40 does require us to think about how do you measure what the benefits are, how do you track all of that, what's covered by it. And so we're spending a lot of time thinking about that and working with others and working with other agencies to make sure that we're doing that in the way the president intended. So we will keep doing that. And as we've already talked about, we've got huge opportunities here with the bipartisan infrastructure law and the Inflation Reduction Act to make sure that we're delivering benefits to those communities. There's also a number of other interesting things going on in the administration. Focus on there's an interagency group that focuses on coal communities that are particularly affected by the transition to cleaner forms of energy, and making sure that the communities that may be affected in that way know what the opportunities are for them to take advantage of resources that are coming through these laws and other opportunities as well. So you really do have an all of government attention on this. And in my position as deputy administrator at EPA, I get to engage with my peers at other agencies. And it's really very exciting how much we're all working together to implement the president's initiative of Justice 40 through his executive order.
Yeah, one of the things that's engaged us and others at Resources for the Future has been measuring benefits. And benefits come, as in many different forms. Some of them come in terms of direct financial flows, like might come through the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund. But then a lot of benefits flow through improvements in air quality and other direct environmental harms, which may not be measured directly in the marketplace, but have tremendous value. So kind of the valuation of those benefits is a key analytic challenge at time, but one that I think folks are making really good progress on. So EPA, kind of speaking to modeling and analysis, EPA has long been a leader in the use of sophisticated modeling and analytic tools and economic analysis to support decision making. And EPA, I think, has continued to improve and update its toolbox, and just measuring distributional impacts is just one of those. So in November, just a few months ago, EPA put out a kind of a reproposed rule for reducing methane emissions in the oil and gas sector. And as part of the regulatory analysis for that rulemaking, introduced a new measurement of the social cost of carbon and other greenhouse gases that responded to a number of important recommendations by the National Academy of Sciences. So in that was part kind of a supplementary analysis to the regulatory analysis. And in that analysis, the central estimate for the social cost of carbon dioxide was $190 per ton, which is over three times the interim value that's being used, which is $51 per ton. And that's in line with a major study that was done by Resources for Future and other experts and published in Nature last fall. So the rule and its analysis is now out for both formal public comment as well as independent scientific review. So my question is, can you speak to the role of analytic tools such as the social cost of carbon in EPA's decision making? And how does EPA's approach to the social cost of carbon and more generally incorporation of updated science into its tools, and what implications might this have for increased SEC for EPA regulatory actions in 2023 and behind? So that's kind of a number of different subparts there. Any reflections on that?
Well, I mean, first of all, we're tending to refer to it as the social cost of greenhouse gases at this point, because it's not just CO2, as you've acknowledged. But it's absolutely, if you're going to do policy right, you need to have this kind of information and these kind of analytic tools. Everybody may not agree down to the penny on all of these things, but you have to have the tools out there to have the conversation. And we're really grateful to be able to work with organizations like yours and others who are thinking about all of this. The social cost of greenhouse gases had not really had an evidence-based update in over a decade. And so it was high time for it. You can't really debate the pros and cons, the benefits and costs of regulatory or program policy without being able to have a discussion about, well, what does this really mean in terms of how it is going to benefit society? And so having an updated and well-based understanding of how you think about the costs and benefits is absolutely critical for people to be able to meaningfully weigh in and express a view on the regulatory work that we're going forward. So we're absolutely committed to having the best science, having the most up-to-date science, having the most transparent discussion of how to develop these tools and then how to use them to support our regulatory work and other sorts of government functions and that really are benefited, are enriched by understanding in a real sense what the benefits are. And as we've already mentioned today, it can be hard to quantify some of those future benefits. And analysts have worked on that for years, and we make progress over time. And that's what we're doing here.
Yep. Well, thank you for those reflections. And I have many more questions, and I'm sure we could talk at length for quite a bit more time, but I see that we're actually out of time, believe it or not. Time flies when you're having such an interesting conversation. So I'm sorry we're gonna have to end it there, but I wanna give, well, first of all, because I want to give due time to our next panel that's about to come up, which will be a panel discussion moderated by Kevin Rennert, who's the director of RFF's Federal Climate Policy Initiative. But Deputy Administrator Janet McCabe, thank you so much for joining us here this morning. It was really a pleasure to hear your perspectives on what's coming up for the next year at EPA, and I hope the audience joins me in thanking you for this opportunity.
Well, thank you so much. It was a real pleasure to join you again. I'm sorry I can't be there in person and hang around for the rest of your day, but have a great program, and we'll look forward to making some big decisions together in 2023.
Excellent. Well, we'll have you back in here in person soon. Have a great day.
All right. Sounds good. All right. Bye, everybody.
Thank you. So with that, we're going to briefly pause, set up the stage, and then bring our panelists up here. Just stay tuned for a minute.
big flashing numbers. It's fairly intimidating. Wonderful. Thank you all again for being here. And thank you, Richard and Deputy Administrator McCabe, for that energizing start to the morning. It's really a pleasure to be with all of you. I'm Kevin Rennert. As Richard said, I'm a fellow here at RFF and the director of our Federal Climate Policy Initiative. I'm so pleased to be joined here today by a distinguished set of experts for our deep dive exploration of the biggest decisions coming forward in 2023. Dr. Homer Wilkes is the Undersecretary for Natural Resources and Environment at the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Juliet Alperin is the Deputy Editor for Climate and Environment at the Washington Post. Dr. Kathleen Hogan is the Principal Deputy Undersecretary for Infrastructure at the Department of Energy. And Jason Grumet, founder and president of the Bipartisan Policy Center. This morning is definitely sort of an inside the beltway conversation with some of the most in-demand experts. For example, we have Undersecretary Wilkes. We'll be having to depart at the top of the hour for an in-person meeting with Secretary Vilsack. So we will try to make all these transitions seamless, and you can sort of judge us from your seats and how we do on that. We suggested to Secretary Vilsack that he should just join our conversation, but apparently he had some big decisions he wanted to make outside of the public eye this morning. So a reminder that we'll be devoting the last 10 minutes of this conversation to Q&A with the audience. If you're on Zoom, please go ahead and use the Q&A box for your online participation. If you're here in the room, get your questions ready because we'll have microphones running around the audience to take them. So with that, let's dive into our first topic with this panel. No surprise here, but the implementation of the Inflation Reduction Act and the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law will be some of the biggest decisions we'll be tracking here in 2023. So as Richard and Deputy Administrator McCabe discussed in their conversation, these acts will be major drivers of U.S. economic activity in the coming years. The two bills together provide unprecedented investments intended to address infrastructure needs, build U.S. industrial capacity to enhance America's competitiveness posture, support a U.S. transition to a clean energy economy, and build domestic climate resilience. The effects of each of these pieces of legislation will hinge critically on their implementation, which is well underway for the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law and is just in the early days for the Inflation Reduction Act. So we can only hope to scratch the surface of these massive bills with the time that we actually have this morning, because we're going to be moving from topic to topic to topic in the hour that we have. But I think I'd like to start here with both Dr. Wilkes and Dr. Hogan to speak specifically to the implementation efforts at USDA and the Department of Energy. So Dr. Wilkes, maybe we can start with you. Can you give us the highlights of what the USDA writ large is going to do in terms of implementation, and specifically what Natural Resources and Environment has in store from implementing these bills over the next 12 months?
Thanks, Kevin, and thanks for the invitation. And thank you, the audience, for coming. This is the opportunity for us to talk about our programs a little bit, so I'm always looking forward to that. So to answer the question is that RA and bill funding have injected much needed funding into the necessary evils out there, and we'll call this thing climate change, for lack of a better word. We're asking that this, we're gonna set up three priorities within USDA. It's a large agency, as you can imagine, but the mission area that I oversee is actually primarily the Forest Service. So we have three major goals or priorities, for lack of a better word. One would be advancing climate equity, mitigating climate change, and improving climate resistance. And that's where the injection of these bill funds as well as our funds will go. And let me give you a couple examples of what USDA we do in that particular area. And let's talk about climate equity. As you can imagine, historically underserved communities are among our most vulnerable to the impacts of climate change. And that's one issue that USDA really want to address as far as those long-term situations, whether it be drought, insects, and all those type of things. But we want to make sure that the underserved communities, tribal entities out there actually are getting the type of exposure they need in order to address some of those concerns. Program in particular, urban forestry, one of the major programs that actually came in RA, we got roughly $1.5 billion, would it be, to actually do some things. So you probably know that trees sequester carbon. That's what we do. So I call myself the tree in that inch. But at the same time, this was about a $35 million program, whereas that we now have an infusion of what's roughly $1.5 billion. So we will be working with partnerships and communities to make sure they're involved in those processes. So stay tuned on that. That's just one example as far as how we have climate equity. The other thing that I would tell you about climate resistance, you hear, you see the wildfires that are taking place in the West and out there in the different parts of the United States. So again, those dollars are infused in there. We went out and we looked at, last year we implemented a 10-year wildfire crisis strategy. We are making improvements in that. We have 10 landscapes, and we are addressing those issues out there through those 10 landscapes, where we infused roughly last year, I don't know, it was, I think, roughly about $1 billion. We're going to go back. We've gone out. I had these roundtables to go and look and see what things need to change. So we're going to infuse another $250 million in to address some of those things that didn't take place during that time. Another issue that we actually did, after listening to those roundtables and look at some of the concerns out there, we were able to identify additional 11 landscapes. So that's one of the things I'm going to go talk to the Secretary about. How do we infuse dollars in those landscapes? So those are some of the utilization of the bill dollars that have taken place. And last, certainly not least, is really climate mitigation that we really want to address with those funds. The national forest, you know, we have roughly 16% of the domestic carbon dioxide emissions per year. But I will go to say that USDA, through the national forest system, that we are able to do a lot of climate mitigation through those type of processes. And this will be done, you know, to celebrate a voluntary conservation practices. We want to do this using voluntary approach. We just heard from my sister agency, EPA, you know, some of their rules are a little different than USDA. We have done things on a voluntary approach, and we do what is called more or less I would incentivize you to do some of those things there. With the right tools and the partnership, I think we can get these jobs actually done. One last and final thing that I'll talk about as far as climate mitigation. I think it's been going on now about 6 months. We infused roughly about $3.1 billion through climate smart agriculture, where we had industry, large corporation, small farmers, as well as other underserved communities participate in a $3.1 billion process where we really want to actually put this conservation practice on the ground, work with communities to make those things happen. So those are some of the things in the funding that have come out of USDA in this RA and bill funded.
Thank you for that. Certainly a lot of activity on the road ahead. Dr. Hogan, how is the Department of Energy approaching implementation of these two bills?
I think we're all in on implementing these bills. You know, you heard from EPA and the extensiveness of the resources coming there, extensive resources at USDA. When you look at the Department of Energy, we're getting close to $100 billion across the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law and the Inflation Reduction Act. We shortened those to a bill in IRA. And in addition to that, beyond sort of that funding, we have hundreds of billions of dollars in loan authority, as well as we are looking at what we need to do to leverage the additional resources coming through in IRA for tax incentives, since so much of what we're trying to do is really maximize the use of this money, and a lot of this is going to come together on the ground as communities put it to use. So what have we been able to do in this first year? We've done a lot. You know, as you can imagine, this type of funding coming into an agency like the Department of Energy, you can't really just implement it through the way the department was organized historically, which is largely a research and demonstration organization. So we have built out a whole new office, the Office of Infrastructure, that I'm here representing, and again, an exciting opportunity to do this, because it stretches the whole department into a new area of more demonstration and deployment. So we are thinking through really a new agency for the next decade or so, more hopefully, to get to work with brand new muscle, as we call it, around how we engage at the community level in what we need to do around this clean energy transition. So new muscle for community engagement, new muscle for manufacturing supply chains. So much of what we need to do with a clean energy transition is not just sort of transition sort of the well-known fossil-based assets that are out there, but what is the whole supply chain that goes with that? And how, as the world transitions, do we grow out our economic opportunity in this country in a way that, of course, we would all like to see? And I think that's also where a lot of the economic opportunity for the communities that we are so interested in comes from as we build out these multifaceted supply chains. So That's a lot of what we're looking to do. I mean, the big areas that this money is coming to the department to support, it's things like building out and hardening our electricity grid. We know we need a different grid based on where the energy supply now is, the clean energy supplies relative to where we've come from. So we need a sort of different network out there, and it needs to connect supply and demand, and it needs to be hardened to deal with any number of threats, including cybersecurity, which we know is present and growing in many different ways. So we're active in all of that. And then really building out U.S. clean energy manufacturing, as I mentioned. And then a lot of the funding that we're getting through Bill and Ira, too, is to improve our building infrastructure. So a lot of funding going to low-income housing to reduce their energy burdens, as well as dollars just to improve the efficiency of the building stock. We know as we want to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and improve sort of the comfort in the buildings that we all live and work in, there's a lot of technologies to put to play there. You've got to do it in a sort of effective way as you move towards perhaps more electrified uses. And you have to do it hand in hand with insulating those buildings so that you are very smart about the electricity draws that you need over time as well. So just a lot to think through there. And just, I guess, one more thought I'd like to put out there on this is, because Janet touched on this morning, too. It's like, we have all this funding, right? It really is historic. At the same time, it does not fund an entire clean energy transition. So where is most of the money going to come from for this? It's from the private sector, right? So as we're thinking about how to use this funding, we're putting a lot of time and energy into how do you get the most from these dollars in a catalytic way to really bring in the private sector every step of the way so that they can come in and really become the wave, the major wave of the transition going forward. So those are the things we're thinking through and working to put into action at the department.
Thank you. That's a really critical connection, this connection to the private sector in the work that you're doing. And I hope that we can come back to that later in the conversation. For right now, I'd like to actually open up to Juliet and to Jason. Juliet, how is the coverage of the Washington, what do you think about it at the Washington Post and as you cover these kind of the ongoing implementation of these two different bills?
Well, one of the things we're really looking at is, of course, how does President Biden and his deputies, how do they leverage their executive authority to basically get this money out the door, enact the rules that are gonna change the playing field when it comes to decisions on energy and environmental issues. And so we're certainly gonna focus on whether it's the accountability reporting to look at how this money is being spent, what impact it's going to have on communities across the country, including obviously a bunch of these disadvantaged environmental justice communities, which has been a real priority for the president and a group of Americans who have been disproportionately affected by pollution. So we'll look at things like that. And as we just heard, looking at how does this reverberate in the private sector? And one of the questions is how swiftly can these decisions be made? And what does that mean for example, the deployment of clean energy? As someone who, for example, covered a number of climate and environmental policies enacted by President Obama, reversed by President Trump, then reversed another time by President Biden, one of the things that we're always looking for are what are the decisions that have staying power? And so, for example, when you deploy, and I'm sure Jason will be talking about this, when you deploy an offshore wind project, that's something that tends to stay in the ground even if a Democrat leaves office and a Republican comes in. We've seen that certainly with a number of renewable energy projects on land. But now there's been certainly some delays in what's happening in terms of offshore wind. So what does that end up meaning for the long-term impact? Or if you're going to put into place a policy that's taking into account the social cost of greenhouse gases, is that something that affects, you know, critical infrastructure decisions and how a highway is built? I mean, I think those are some of the real questions that we'll be exploring in the months to come.
Excellent. And Jason, what will you be watching for in 2023 with respect to these two pieces of legislation?
Well, so the decision to invest about $400 billion, maybe almost half $1 trillion in these kind of technologies, exciting, because actually it gives us the potential of trying to address the climate problem through innovation and not deprivation, which I think is the only way we will actually build a meaningful, durable solution. Having crossed the threshold, though, to not just talking about the issue in theory, we now have to confront some challenges that we really hadn't grappled with before, and that kind of like timing and trade-offs. So this is a bipartisan simplification, but for the last 20 years, conservatives have not been great thinking about the urgency of the problem. And it seems to me that for the next 20 years, we can't have progressives be just as bad thinking about the urgency of the solution. And that's the direction I think we're heading, right? So as a species, we're really good when it comes to self-deception around time. I have a 14-year-old son who has taught me new kind of genetic depths of procrastination. I know people who set their alarm clocks ahead to like deceive themselves. Spousal deception is something I've participated in on long commutes home. There is absolutely no honesty about the urgency of this problem when we think about these solutions. And so I think we're going to have to start at the end and start to come back and think about what does it really mean to fundamentally transition an economy. Talking a little bit then about trade-offs, Richard said time flies when you're having fun. So the good news and the bad news is that government is now having an incredible amount of fun. This is an amazing challenge, and it is almost impossible for federal employees not to want to make it perfect. That's not going to get it done in time. There has to be a little bit of a humility in the recognition that we just got to push some stuff out the door and get some stuff built. And then there's even harder trade-offs. So just about everybody talked about domestic jobs. Incredibly important. 20 years ago, 83 senators passed the permanent normalization of trade with China. And we made a commitment to shift our sights towards vast investments in China because it was going to support the reformers, it was going to open up their markets, it was going to improve their civil rights. Didn't work. Fundamentally didn't work. Now we have a national commitment to shift, which has to happen as fast as possible. But if we try to make it happen faster than possible, we are going to essentially choke out that transition. I think there's a very significant risk of that because no one wants to acknowledge how difficult it's going to be, not just to bring factories, but the intellectual property back to the US. And then, you know, one of my favorite issues is we've got to build stuff. And in my 20 years of work at the BPC, the one thing that has really united Democrats and Republicans is the reluctance to see any infrastructure of any kind within their broad field of vision. And our 50-year-old statutes and our 200-year-old presumption of local power, just not going to work. And so we're talking about some serious efforts about ways that we can make some changes. But if we don't actually think honestly about the time frames, not only are we going to fail to spend this money, but we're going to fundamentally fail to use it in the way that is necessary to solve the climate problem.
Excellent. That's a great place to pause because we're going to come right back to that that question about kind of obstacles to clean energy transition in just a little bit as a future topic. But right now, I want to pivot just a bit to talk about Congress. And in light of the somewhat rocky start to the 118th Congress, it's possible that some observers have been skeptical about the possibility of the current Congress taking significant bipartisan action to address climate change in the kind of divided Congress and in the kind of current polarized times. But there are some opportunities that have historically transcended partisan politics. And one of those is the Farm Bill, which is up for revisitation this year and has historically been able to transcend these politics because it is so vast. It touches so many different parts of the economy and addresses so many different kind of diverse stakeholders that it's been able to pull together coalitions to get it moving. So as we'll talk about Congress more broadly in a second, but let's start with the Farm Bill here. Undersecretary Wilkes, what do you see as the potential opportunity from USDA's perspective for addressing climate change and resilience in this next Farm Bill? And what do you think might be new and distinctive in the 2023 Farm Bill related to the kinds of investments and programs that were put forward in the IRA and Bill?
Very interesting question. And a thing I appreciate, Julie, both Jason given me a perspective on what the expectations are from a standpoint of the implementation. So let me just start with this. We've gotten a large infusion of dollars from this Congress and bill that's very, very appropriate. And well, you know, it's the bipartisan infrastructure law. So I'm going to start there, that Congress, they have a platform to start from, and everyone is beginning to take, they want to see this implemented within their respective areas. From my perspective, and with USDA, as Jason talked about, its implementation, it's pretty hectic. You know, it's an infusion of dollars, and no agency was really ready to implement that. I mean, it's a repurposing, refocusing, just recalibration to get those kind of dollars out there, because we have these programs that you began to implement, and we have a traditional way of implementing. But we're seeing how we're getting these dollars out this time. It's going to be up through partnership agreements. So I'm hopeful that the farm bill will increase things as far as just making sure that there's opportunities to leverage, take some of those barriers down that agency have. And we have an opportunity sometime to not lobby Congress, but we also provide them technical assistance based on some of the tools that may be needed in order for us to implement the things that they have asked us to do. So I'm hopeful that this new farm bill that comes up will address some of the requirements that we have in both bill and IRA to take down some of those barriers that to make it easy for us to implement, to make it easy for us to leverage these things. As we began to talk about grants and agreements, you know, there's a percentage that you have to have. Maybe some of those things can actually be taken down. And I just think that this whole climate piece, people are really paying attention to it. The dollars are there. And if we can show the members of Congress, based on the dollars we already have, that they'll have an appetite to actually give more dollars to address those things out there. When I talk about climate resistance, I'm talking about climate mitigation, we're talking about just equity. And we really are serious about this equity piece. And I've seen from the standpoint of correspondence that we get in USDA, they're asking those questions. How do we provide the information, the dollars in those communities so they can be responsible and responsive to the requests that may come out of Congress? So that's what I'm seeing, and I think that there's an opportunity that it will work. Folks have the same interests. They really believe now that climate change is real. You need to address it, and that's why I think we have those large infusion of dollars that have come in to the various agencies, and whether it be EPA, whether it be USDA, whether it be whatever the other agencies out there, to make this happen, because John Q. Public is asking for it, and people are really interested in it. And when you start looking at places like California, you have drought, insect, you flooding. When the insurance industries in those places come in and they start communicating that, you're going to pay, it's like that Fram commercial. You're going to pay on the front end, you can pay on the back end. So I think that with these various agencies out here and the tools that we have in our toolbox, we can help with that mitigation. So I think Congress will pay attention to that. So those are the types of things that I see that will be coming in and talk about how do we take these dollars that's already in bill, we get them implemented, and making sure that there's an inclusion of both public and private sector to make it happen.
Thank you. Jason, I'm going to bring the conversation back to you. You've long been at the center of kind of thoughtful conversations between bipartisan groups and found, you know, ways to find productive ways to move forward in a bipartisan fashion on climate change. As you think about the Farm Bill or other things that the Congress might be, you know, moving forward on this Congress, what are the dynamics that you're watching and what are the opportunities that you see, you know, for action here in the coming Congress, or the current Congress?
So let me give you kind of like an ecosystem answer and then a couple of specifics. Everyone wonders what can happen in the House, right? The Senate demonstrated remarkable bipartisan collaboration in the last Congress. There are two dynamics that Speaker McCarthy has to address, right? There's the just kind of pending frustration, anger coming from the far right, and avert your eyes for the first 3 or 4 months. It's just gonna be an expression of all of that aggression. But the reason that he is the Speaker is not because of that vote as much as the 20 Republicans who were basically elected in Biden blue states. Those are the majority makers. If the Speaker wants to be the Speaker again, they need to be reelected. They are not running on the block everything agenda. They've got to get some stuff done. So this is why being Speaker is hard. He's going to have to find opportunities to do both those things. I think you're right. I think there are some opportunities around energy and climate that fit into that other mold. Farm Bill is an excellent example. You know, they passed the Growing Climate Solutions Act in this last Congress in a very bipartisan way, which is an extension of that recognition on ag. We're going to be talking about permitting a whole lot. I also think that there is some room on the implementation of these two bills if we move fast enough. I think people like having new technologies and jobs and some narrative about the future in their districts. And it's pretty essential that some of that starts to happen in the next 18 months, which I think is possible, but at the moment, pretty unlikely.
And Juliet, what are you tracking with respect to Congress?
Well, I think, you know, what's interesting is that as someone who's covered politicians for quite some time, they love providing carrots. And that's part of what we're talking about in the Farm Bill, right? There's plenty of, and the growing solutions. There's plenty of opportunities for bipartisan cooperation on essentially voluntary incentives. I think one of the questions, when again, just take the Farm Bill for example, when you look at agriculture, this is a sector in America that's being incredibly hard hit by climate change. One of the most powerful stories that I edited in the last several months was Annie Gowan, who's based in Kansas, went out to Nebraska and areas surrounding there to look at the impact that the drought is having on ranchers. And essentially, at this point, there are, you know, individual ranchers who have for generations raised cattle, and that there's real questions about whether that's sustainable going forward. It's also worth noting animal agriculture is responsible for roughly, I believe, 15% of greenhouse gas emissions in the United States. But a real question is, will there be anything in the Farm Bill that's actually going to push for a shift in the highest emitting parts of the farm sector? Or essentially, you know, will there be some voluntary incentives that won't do much to change these broad factors that are actually yielding to greater greenhouse gas emissions? So those are some of the things that I think it's important to look at. In terms of permitting, there is, you know, a possibility, again, for some sort of bipartisan solution. That's one of the, I think, what will be one of the most areas of active discussion. And there's kind of this question of whether both sides are going to be willing to make trade-offs, which will essentially mean, you know, what level of additional permitting flexibility would you have for fossil fuel projects in exchange for getting some of the concessions that you'll need and streamlining that would actually lead to greater deployment of renewable energy. And how those calculations are made ultimately will have a huge impact on what happens with the climate and the environment.
Now, let's bring our focus now back to the executive branch to talk about what to expect with respect to actions to address environmental justice in the coming year. Now, as Richard and Deputy Administrator McCabe discussed this morning, we're close on the heels of the two-year anniversary of announcement of the Biden administration's Justice 40 initiative, which aims to deliver at least 40% of benefits to communities that are underserved, historically marginalized, and disproportionately impacted by pollution. Now, Dr. Hogan, let's go back to you. As part of the administration's whole of government approach, I understand that Justice 40 has been a key priority for the Department of Energy as well. Can you tell us how DOE is implementing Justice 40 and where can we expect to see growth and opportunity in 2023?
Yeah, I mean, as you know, Justice 40 is just a huge priority across everything that we do. We've stood up a new office that addresses these issues. They've reviewed all the spending programs, Bill Ira, of what we do. Basically, when you deal with energy and clean energy, basically everything has a Justice 40 aspect to it. So we are looking to put all the funding to work in a way that, of course, delivers on the Justice 40 objectives. Some of the things we've done more particularly, all the big solicitations that we are putting out the door, the applicants have to put together a community benefits plan, and that community benefits plan get scored as we look at which applicants we are going to move forward on. So what's in a community benefits plan? It's how are you going to engage the community where you look to site the thing that you are doing? How do you look to build out jobs and make connections so that people from hard-hit communities get trained up and can actually be the people that are the recipients of the growth and the jobs on the ground? And things like that. To the extent there's permitting issues that need to be addressed, how do you get the community in early and throughout the entire process? And on one hand, that's great because of the benefits that can be delivered. On the other hand, that's really just good engagement so that you can address what can be roadblocks in a process later on. You know, I think we, just so I can speak to some of Jason's comments a little earlier, you know, as we move out on all the work that we have to do here, again, we think that there's going to be just a tremendous amount of activity this year, the next year, with the Bill and IRA funding. One of the areas that we've already gotten out the door is $2.8 billion in battery materials refining and processing awards. Many of those projects that we have announced and are now negotiating are near communities that have, are disadvantaged in terms of their characteristics. So excited to see those getting stood up in terms of those jobs. But it's also ones where the build out of what we need for these critical minerals to support the electric vehicle supply chain, it's one of these great areas to build things out here and really compete with some of the other countries around the world. So when we look at just the set that we've been able to put out with this first round of awards, it's about half of the money. We see that we will have about a very substantial amount of the lithium capability in this country that we need to support lithium-ion batteries by 2030, right? So there's just some great examples of what we can do here to build this out in this country for the long term, again, to meet our environmental objectives, economic development, and sort of returning these jobs here in this country, all with benefits to the communities of interest. So that's the kind of thing you will see over and over from the department.
Kevin, can I just add one quick thought, which is government's working faster than ever before. I mean, unbelievable amounts of effort. My admonition is to civil society, which is let you guys breathe a little bit. You just talked about lithium. I'm sure you're aware of the incredible opposition to all efforts to mine lithium in the United States of America. We just got to choose, right? That is a trade-off. If we want to onshore stuff, we can't be colonists, right? We have to actually do things here, and there are going to be trade-offs. And I think it is very hard for a government. There's a B.B. King song, I'm built for comfort, not built for speed. I think it is very hard for government to overcome that challenge if not given actual room and encouragement from civil society.
And Dr. Wilkes, I know you need to run to your meeting, but maybe before you go, could you actually speak to what USDA is doing and how Natural Resources and Environment has prioritized Justice 40 in its work?
Very much so, Kevin, and thanks for the opportunity. Let me just tell you, I'm very proud of what USDA is doing, in that arena. I'm proud of what the administration is doing to address concerns. And I'll tell you what, meeting those goals can be challenging, but you have to get out there and work, folks. And what I'm most comfortable with, I take the tribal summit that was held in November, that President Biden had here. And we had roughly 150 tribal units that actually came in. And our application process, there's a total, I think, DOI and USDA, we put together probably about 20 of those proposals that came in that was actually recognized, there by the president. But in addition to that, there was 60 applications that came in, that grants and awards that came to USDA. So we had an additional summit that X date from tribal engagement. And I'm here to tell you, that summit has generated a lot of concerns and requests for USDA and other agencies out there because people know they can get involved. We have to worry about whether it be the sacred monuments. We have to worry about, just think about what Dr. Hogan was talking about, those precious minerals on Forest Service land. We have to address that. So it's a combination of balance and making sure that you take care of those ancestral lands and things. And those are some of the things that USDA is doing. I was looking for some numbers that we had put out roughly some, we have these, that sacred land, folks are looking for land exchange and things of that nature. So we're working and using the tool co-stewardship, co-management, to make sure that folks get a chance to work together there and we find out how the best way to manage those lands. So that's what USDA is doing. We're, we're putting dollars in there, but at the same time, we're having a lot of consultations with the tribes to determine what is the best way that we can co-manage those lands that's out there. And that's a big ticket item in the administration. When we start talking about diversity, equity, inclusion, accessibility, we try to make sure that the folks get a chance to participate and understand what's taking place in those arenas there. Both Julie and Jason have said that's the things they'll be watching. So I'm glad we are somewhat ahead in that process of trying to make sure we get some of those things implemented.
Wonderful. Okay. Thank you very much. And thank you for your participation today on the panel.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Sure, as I take Dr. Wilkes' chair, that's maybe the closest that I get in the future to becoming an undersecretary myself. So we're gonna shift gears a bit and talk about overcoming the obstacles to this clean energy transition. This has come up in a number of different ways this morning already in the discussion, so let's go right at it. Obviously the economic modeling of the IRA and the bill legislation has shown that they have substantial investments that are substantial enough that they can be transformative, especially in the power sector. But those models often don't really represent these real-world obstacles that keep coming up and the challenges to particularly citing infrastructure in general, and certainly big ticket items like transmission that are expected to be critical to the net zero kind of economy in the future. So, Dr. Hogan, from your perspective, what are some of the key obstacles that need to be overcome with respect to siting infrastructure, and where does the decision-making power actually reside to address these questions, and how is DOE thinking about this?
Well, again, across the $100 billion that we're moving out, right, there's just projects of, that are very different, which then face different types of issues. Certainly, if you're trying to repurpose one asset, retool it, et cetera, then it's a different conversation. Certainly, there's a lot of permitting and reviews that need to go on, and we'll be working through all of that. And then, Bill and Ira brought resources to the table to help us address that as well. It's like NEPA review, human resource capital. Then you also, of course, have the issues with transmission, which has been a big issue in this country. There's not been a lot of big transmission projects in the last bunch of years. But I think one of the things we're very excited about there, again, is the IRA funding that has brought forth the opportunity to work with siting authorities across the country in what they would like to do to address these permitting issues. So we've got, an RFI on the street right now to help us design a transmission permitting grant. It's a grant making capacity to help siting authorities work through a lot of these issues. So how can we get that money out on the ground so that they can engage people appropriately in what these opportunities are? I mean, I think to Jason's point, so much of this is getting in front of these conversations. So you can't make something happen when people aren't aware of what it is and what the pros and cons are. It's like, how do you have people have the capability to go out, really engage the community in the real conversation of the different pathways in front of them so that they really can be part of that decision making? And I think creating that environment where you can do that and working through these things is really what we have to get on top of so that people do embrace these things. So, and again, we've been given a lot of the tools to start this, and we will be doing it as quickly as we can.
So DOE definitely has tools to support some of these decisions and has been sort of empowered to do that in a lot of ways. Julie, maybe I turn to you. Where else do you see the decisions needing to be made, and what's, who are the actors that need to take action in the coming year to really get at the heart of these issues?
Well, I mean, it's really across the federal government. We, we'll need to see what unfolds. For example, obviously, Janet McCabe indicated where things stand in terms of EPA, an agency which again is behind on schedule on several key decisions. If you look at the Department of Transportation, that's a department that's playing an outsized role in a number of these issues. So when you look at now, transportation has surpassed the power sector in terms of a driver of greenhouse gas emissions in this country. And so, I think that's, they're gonna be a major player. You look at the Interior Department, which along as we had Dr. Wilkes talk about, balancing the needs for land protection and tribal rights and along with some of these actions. And I think that you'll see it. So, I mean, really there's almost not, a department or an agency under this president that's not going to be playing a role. And then again, you have all these private sector players that are going to have a huge amount. For example, when you look at how the Inflation Reduction Act was written, big banks are going to be playing a huge role in terms of lending money for a number of these projects. That's something that, again, is both deserves scrutiny, but also will affect, you know, what happens. And so I just think that there are a number of different players that will, you know, leave their mark and will either work very quickly and have a huge impact, or will have some delays, which ultimately will lead to a slower transition.
Yeah, definitely a dispersed set of responsibilities. I noticed neither of you mentioned Congress, so Jason, I'm going to turn back to you and see if you want to speak to.
Yeah,
you know,
love the job of being the Congress whisperer. Right.
Yep.
I also got to. I love that you're actually participating and reporting on this panel at the same time.
I got to help out one of my colleagues.
Well,
I'm always a multitasker.
I'm Marty from multitasking. All right, so when it comes to Congress, and again, I'll abstract a little bit. It's a question of what do we want to permit, right? We all talk about the energy transition. We like to talk about where we want to go. But the first step in a transition is where we are. And unless we actually have an honest conversation about how we move from here to there, we're going to have segments of the society fighting against building linear infrastructure, really tough, on both sides of the equation. So if you just think about, you know, natural gas for a moment, and the transition towards hydrogen, which is probably one of the most significant opportunities that's kind of moved quickly into this discussion, we are not going to have a national hydrogen infrastructure if the oil and gas industry feels fundamentally alienated from participation at the outset. It's just not going to happen. You can't accelerate the future by screwing up the present. And until, you know, and the White House, I think, the president talks about this in general terms, but unless we're much more direct, much more honest, not the way you, I mean, I don't want to talk about like a war footing, but something closer to that than just a happy chat about incentives. You know, you have to have both sides aligned. Juliet named the basic dynamic of it's got to be a combination of enabling permitting for, you know, natural gas infrastructure while advancing transmission and the siting of clean energy. And it has to be a transition. And so I just come back with everything that the government's doing. The word transition is the only way this gets done. We have to show where we want to go. You have to set the long-term market signal. You cannot obligate people to achieve that long-term market signal right away. And so in my mind, it's just a question of how thoughtfully and pragmatically and aggressively we understand how to manage that transition.
And just to elaborate on that, when you talk about Congress again, obviously this Jason's point is framed in terms of collaboration and then in terms of opposition. You know, we're going to have oversight hearings. That's going to take up people's time. If this money doesn't get out the door, it's going to be reprogrammed. There are a number of ways in which particularly we will see the House seek to put the brakes on part of this transition, and then the question is going to be, you know, what are there ways that it's going to be redirected that's, you know, going to have a real impact, or you know, is it simply going to be, you know, a further essentially slowing down without a, you know, significant shift in the trajectory? So those are some of the questions.
Excellent. I see we are starting to run towards the time of having audience Q&A. And so as we transition to audience Q&A, first of all, get your questions ready. We'll have microphones running around and put them in the Q&A box in Zoom if you're out there in Zoom land. Thank you. But as we make that transition, I'd love to turn to you. I did my best in organizing this conversation to get topics that seemed relevant and span all of the expertise that we had on the panel. But what did I miss? I pose this to all of you. What should we have been talking about? What are you tracking that actually hasn't come up yet in this conversation? Happy to start with any of you.
Trade policy.
Trade policy, okay.
So we talked a little bit about supply chain. We do not have a domestic supply chain adequate to this task. And so we have to navigate that through our broader trade relationships, which are messy as heck and complicated and not pretty. And I think that there's just not clarity about what we want to do as a country. And so I think you know, the House Select Committee on China is going to try to bring their clarity. I think, you know, there's a lot of effort in kind of the progressive organized labor community to also want to move understandably with urgency to restore the lost manufacturing base and middle class in this country. That's not going to be negotiated by DOE or EPA or Ag. That's coming out of state and Homeland Security and, you know, Customs and Commerce.
And do you see this talk of a border carbon adjustments as an overlay on that conversation, or how does that fit with this conversation about trade?
So that's like the delightful optimism, right, which basically says the good news is that our economy is inherently, you know, less carbon intensive per economic production than a lot of other countries, so let's own that advantage and use that as a leverage point to put pressure on China and others to lift up their game. And so that's absolutely part of the equation. And we have to put that pressure on them while putting the same pressure on ourselves to use Chinese technology and intellectual property if we actually want to build a clean energy economy.
Yeah, well, I would just follow up and say, I mean, I think the solar industry is a great example of kind of the trade tensions that Jason was just speaking to. And if you look at, you know, enforcement, for example, against Chinese solar companies and what that's meant for affecting the supply chain, that's one of the much more tangible real world impacts that we're seeing of some of this policy as opposed to a border tax adjustment, which I think, you know, many people would be surprised if that's something that's, you know, adopted in the next couple of years, which doesn't mean it you know, it can't be, but it's much harder to do something than that than crack down on Chinese imports, which is something we're seeing here and now.
Right. Dr. Hogan, did I miss anything today, or did I nail it?
certainly there's a lot of issues here, but I think you've nailed it for now.
Excellent. Well, with that, let's transition to Q&A with the audience. I see a hand going up here. Do we have microphones that are? Maybe I stated there were microphones running around, but actually towards the front row, right here. Thank you. And please go ahead and state your name and your affiliation.
Chris Nye with Argus Media. This is a question for Deputy Undersecretary Hogan. It's no secret that House Republicans are looking for the next Solyndra. They've said as much. But you have to do a lot of high-risk projects like hydrogen, carbon capture. So are you thinking about that actively? Is it basically inevitable that you create the next Solyndra by funding some of these high-risk projects? Or is that something that you're basically comfortable with because you know that's you have to do some higher-risk projects?
A few answers to that. I mean, one, I think Solyndra stands in a class of its own for any number of reasons. So certainly it's an example of something that didn't work, but like let's just leave that aside. I think as we look at what we're doing, we are very deliberately thinking through how to move this money, how not to be so risk-averse that you don't get the impact that you should be getting with this funding. You do want to take risk. You want to take thoughtful risk. But you also want to be communicating effectively with all your stakeholders on how you manage a portfolio, right? So if the portfolio is successful, you are successful. I mean, that is what risk management is about. So yes, presumably there will be things that won't work as well as you had hoped they would. But we've also standing up new capabilities in the department, as I've said, in this new Office of Infrastructure. This new office we've created, the Office of Clean Energy Demonstrations, you should just take a look at it. We are bringing in the capability to do our own third-party financial oversight as we walk through these various large-scale projects that we are running. And, you know, we are doing this. Congress is with us, too. It actually turns out that in the appropriations language that came through this past year, they want us to lean in and do additional internal oversight on any project that has federal funding of over $100 million or more. So we were sort of already doing this, and now we are doing it. but that's the type of thing that we're building out, so we will be addressing this risk that's out there head on and making sure we're on top of things as they change as well. So we hope we're ready, and again, we do want to manage expectations. The expectation cannot be, unfortunately, that every project works perfectly, because then you didn't hit the risk profile correctly.
Thanks. Other questions? And as we're queuing up another question, maybe a quick follow-up. To what extent does sort of the repowering aspect of IRA, for example, like the Section 1706 program where you're taking existing things and transitioning, how does that change the conversation from, you know, building new kind of innovative projects and so on and so forth? And how do you see that supporting the energy transition?
You know, again, we're very excited with all these tools. The particular provision you're speaking to is $250 billion in loan authority to help fossil fuel-based assets retool, repurpose. So it can be for manufacturing purposes or for retooling to be a clean power site. So again, just another tool to use in engaging you know, stakeholders, the private sector, in what can be really a transition led as much as possible by the private sector. I mean, I think that's one of the exciting things about what the loan guarantee program offers. It's we're guaranteeing the loan and we have loan authority, but it's other people's money. It has to make sense from their perspective. So it's a great way to sort of get going on this transition, them finding the places that work. And then of course, our additional resources where you put more taxpayer dollars as part of the projects, up to a 50-50 cost share. I mean, those are interesting projects too. You know, we're not paying for these things entirely. There are a lot of private sector money coming to the table, meaning they think there's something there to be working with as well. So again, a lot of tools to help fashion what we hope will be a good transition in all these places while putting the money to work well.
Excellent.
Ken, while you stare at the audience uncomfortably, the risk profile question, I think, is absolutely essential. I think Kathleen provided a really, you know, strong answer. It's just going to have to be really loud. You know, the reality that it's very hard to justify failure is just fundamental to bureaucracy. I think if you're a venture capitalist and you're right, you know, 9 out of 10 times, you're probably a billionaire. If you're a DOE employee, you're right, 9 out of 10 times, you're probably indicted, right? I mean, just the incentive structure is fundamentally different. And we will not succeed if we don't have a lot of failure. And there's just, you just can't talk about it enough. And you have to put it in really blunt terms. You know, 1 out of every 10 things is just gonna fail. It just is. And you gotta get CEOs who drilled dry holes to come in and say, you know, we fail a lot. And that culture of, you know, kind of swashbuckling failure is what's made the country succeed, and we're also gonna just get crushed when they happen. But I think we have to be talking about that almost all the time.
That's great. I mean, I think some of the other things we're doing, I mean, you bring up the hydrogen hubs as an example. This is gonna be a great set of projects across the country. You know, we've just gotten in the concept papers right before the holidays. So we had a $7 billion solicitation on the street. We got 80-ish concept papers. One of the steps we're taking is we give the applicants an encourage-discourage response. You know, basically, you know, you are really strong in 7 of 10 things, and so you're encouraged to come back and please put some more work into those weakness areas. So I think we encouraged a little over a third of the initial applications. So we expect really strong full applications to come in the spring and then to make these awards. And what we will have is a set of places that are really seeking to build out as hydrogen hubs for this country, to be these initial, and again, when we talk about the new muscle at the Department of Energy, this isn't like to buy down technology risk. What we're looking to do is demonstrate whole business, successful business ecosystems around how you produce the hydrogen and the offtakes for the hydrogen and a sustainable business ecosystem, which will be the basis for something that can continue to grow out and expand. So that's going to be very interesting. But the other thing just to look at is the dollars the department put out was $7 billion. It wasn't the $8 billion that Congress appropriated. It was $7 billion. What's the other billion for? One of the things it's for is to keep an eye on the things that aren't quite working the way they're proposed in the original applications. And to the extent these projects need to zig and zag in the future at certain points in time, how do you help them do the zigging and the zagging so that they can be fully successful in terms of the larger objective?
Excellent. Well, our time is rapidly coming to a close. I can squeeze in one more for our president and CEO if he would like. Go ahead, please, yes.
You can decide okay. If this is a quick one okay. Or not. All right, so I want to reflect back on one of the pieces of the conversation I was having with Janet McCabe, a deputy administrator from the EPA, about what our expectations might be for EPA regulations. But I guess a question to at least some of the panelists, what is your sense of the expectations for different stakeholders that are watching EPA in terms of how far EPA might go on a number of different regulatory fronts? There's a lot of new technology that's available, one could imagine. Even if you go within the constraints of Supreme Court decisions and go site by site, facility by facility, there are now technologies that can scrub carbon. There's also issues like the renewable fuels standard, which is now entirely in EPA's domain. So there's questions there about kind of the non-delegation doctrine and what we might be expecting there. So are there, this is a kind of a packed question, but any quick reactions in terms of what you think folks are expecting EPA to do in terms of its kind of regulatory authority, how far it will kind of use that muscle that it potentially does have?
I'm not quite sure. All I would say is that certainly some of the rules that we have seen recently, including the PM 2.5 ruling that just came out of EPA, we've seen more tentative rulings coming out of EPA. Certainly there are those in the environmental community that expected more aggressive regulation. And so clearly, when our sense is that these agency officials are mindful of Supreme Court precedent and legal challenges, and so that is what we've seen in the run-up to these rules. But again, it is a little bit of a mystery of what they're going to do on some of these rules going forward.
Should I would just add that, you know, it's great to be at RFF so I can answer on one hand and on the other, which I know is kind of the core to the economic field. Technology is zooming. And as you point out, so much of EPA's regulatory structure is based on the best available emission system control. So that's empowering. At the same time, we just got $400 billion for kind of an incentive-driven answer, which is seen as the alternative to the regulatory and tax-driven answer. And so I think there's a lot of motivation to let that technology mature and succeed a little bit. And that's going to be, I think, the tension within the large dynamic agency.
And certainly the deputy administrator spoke to that, and I think the fact that she did gives some of an indication of what folks at the agency are thinking.
Well, with that, I'm sorry to say we're going to have to end things there. But before we go, please join me in thanking our panel of experts, Juliet, Dr. Hogan, Jason. And as a reminder, this event has been recorded and will be available to watch in full at rff.org. Thanks for joining us. Here's to a year of big decisions to come.